There's sometimes a buggy, irresponsible opinions about classic film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, the final entry in 1943, Universal. Pair of very oddball genre entries, The Strange Death of Adolf Hitler, and Son of Dracula. First, let's dip into Joel W. Finler's The Hollywood Story. We'll take a look at his chart of players at the studio under contract in 1943. As always, this comes with the disclaimer that we are not always entirely sure how Finler arrived at his judgments, but he gives a 1, 2, or 3 star rating to each player, and this, we believe, reflects his perception of their value to the studio on the marquee during the length of their contract at the studio. Lon Chaney Jr., 1 star.
Ooh, ouch.
Maria Montez, 2 stars. Abbott and Costello, 3 stars. Donald O'Connor, 1 star. Sabu, 2 stars. Deanna Durbin, of course, 3 stars. And Basil Rathbone, 1 star.
That's it. Sad.
Well, you got a few huge draws there, and then some people that are bringing in some moderate bucks in serials, right? Like Rathbone.
Son of Dracula, though, was a hit.
It was. But we're going to be talking about Strange Death of Adolf Hitler first. So this is Clive Hirschhorn writing the Universal story and his opinion of the Strange Death of Adolf Hitler.
We don't usually like him, do we?
He's pretty hit and miss. A lurid exploitation melodrama. The Strange Death of Adolf Hitler was a curiosity that starred Ludwig Donath in a dual role, Adolf Hitler and the Viennese Franz Huber, Hitler's double. Gail Sondergaard played Huber's wife, who, in the course of the screenplay, Fritz Kortner wrote from his and Joe Mai's original story, has the misfortune to shoot her husband in the belief that he is really Hitler.
Spoilers!
Under James Hogan's direction, it all added up to little more than potboiler entertainment. Also in the cast were George Dolenz, Frederick German, William Trenck, Meryl Roden, Charles Bates, and Ludwig Stossel. The production was by Ben Pivar.
I don't know that I exactly disagree with any of that.
I'm not sure I would call it lurid melodrama.
Unless just anything gratuitously involving Hitler is lurid.
Well, possibly, but I got much more involved with it than I thought I would. The performances are very good.
It is totally idiosyncratic. It's very hard to understand what the point of this was. But I mean, I guess what he means by lurid is using the Hitler angle as a draw. Well, I don't know what's going on by 1943. The awful Nazis are in the news every single day at that point in America. I don't know how much of a service this would be doing in terms of informing people about the Nazi occupation of Austria.
If anything, this would be another signal to Americans that there are good people in the occupied countries in Europe who are in the underground and hoping that Hitler will lose and peace can resume.
At its core, it has this technically tragic story. I mean tragic in Aristotle's definition of tragedy. Classical Greek tragedy where you kill a person that you really love mistakenly.
Yeah, very much so.
And she doesn't even find out that she's done that, so the horror falls upon her husband. It's just an absolute nightmare. It's just a weird Twilight Zone nightmare.
Yeah. Yeah, it does have a very Twilight Zone quality to it. I love the performance of Ludwig Donath and Gail Sondergaard. Ludwig, I've never seen before, or if I have, I didn't know I had.
Why did anyone make this movie? Could it have been to employ all of these stage actors, stage directors appearing in this film who fled the Nazis, many of them from Austria or Hungary? Could that have been the reason?
They had a story to tell. Why not? not tell it. It's certainly got some unique qualities.
So the TCM notes say, although an April 1942 Hollywood Reporter news item announced that Universal had purchased the film rights to an anonymous book called The Strange Death of Hitler in February 1942, all other sources state that the film is based on an original story by Fritz Kortner and Joe Mai. Well, sort of both. Because when I looked up The Strange Death of Adolf Hitler, the first thing that came up was the anonymous book from 1939.
Is it about a doppelganger of Hitler?
It is, but the story is completely different. So, like I said, both. I guess they must have purchased the book and then completely changed the story. This was a book that the publishers claimed was real. It was a true story.
Okay.
Right? Here, I'm just going to read the paragraph summarizing the plot from Wikipedia. According to the book, the author was born Maximilian Bauer. He claims he was arrested by German police in 1933. Subsequently, the Nazi Party came into power and retained him and three others as possible doubles for Hitler. The author claims that on the night before the Munich Agreement, signed 30th September 1938, he dined with Hitler and other high-ranking Nazi officials when the Führer was poisoned via a South American drug. The remaining Nazi leaders quickly decided to maintain the illusion that Hitler was in charge by using the lookalikes as puppet rulers. The book concludes with the author asking Joseph Goebbels for a female concubine and contemplating suicide by gunshot.
Okay.
So it's a conspiracy theory book, I guess, that Hitler is already dead and being impersonated by lookalikes.
Well, the larger point of the film is that it doesn't matter if Hitler's dead. That's driven home pretty forcefully by Fritz Kortner himself, the actor who also wrote the original story.
Well, that's what I was going to say, that there's this core of this weird Twilight Zone tragedy surrounded by sort of an alternate universe framework.
Except that the what if is that it doesn't matter who's in charge in Nazi Germany, you just gotta beat them all. There's a lot more Nazis than just Hitler. That's Kortner's message. Killing him would do nothing. In fact, the movie seems to be arguing that killing him would do harm to the Allied war effort because the generals have a little bit better handle on how to conduct a war than Hitler does.
So did Kortner just write this story in order to advance that thesis?
Well, it certainly seems so. And it's very interesting, too, because the movie kind of has it both ways. It introduces us to Vienna, cultured world capital, a place completely alien to the vicious ideology of Nazism, right?
And of course, Joe Mai is also from Austria.
Now, there were many cultured intellectuals in Vienna, no doubt.
Like Joe Mai.
However, the Austrian people voted overwhelmingly in a plebiscite to let Hitler come and take them over. They loved it. Certainly not people who emigrated, but the movie kind of makes it seem like, oh no, this is an evil external force that has taken over Vienna. On the other hand, so much of the tragedy is driven by guilt of collaborationism, and our hero, who is kidnapped to Berlin and forced to be a doppelganger Hitler, is someone who has been steadily moving up into middle management in the Nazi bureaucracy while secretly hoping that they would lose. His death is kind of depicted as awful because we've come to like him, but on the other hand, he's been just going along with all of this and it's his punishment. And he's willing to die himself. He wants to kill Hitler and put an end to all of this, and he feels like it would atone for his own sins. So there's a lot going on here. The only person who is ultra morally pure is Gail Sondergaard, who has been opposed to Nazism throughout, telling her husband he should not be punching the clock as a Nazi during the day and coming home and voicing his displeasure about it. He should be joining the underground, really, like Fritz Kortner does.
She's really not, even when she's approached by this leader of the underground, even then she doesn't commit herself to the underground, and I think that's part of her downfall. So it's not, you don't want to portray it quite that starkly.
Yeah, you could say that she's responsible too, because she tells Fritz Kortner that she would like to, but she has her children. Maybe you could say that she's also compromised in that way and is doomed to die as well. And for what? I mean, her children definitely have gone over to the Nazis and are going to be raised by their Hitler youth leader.
So Ludwig Donath.
Man, he was great.
So he was an Austrian Jew, graduated from Vienna's Academy of Dramatic Art. He then became a prominent stage actor in Berlin, and when Hitler came to power, he returned to Vienna and worked there in theater and film until the Anschluss. And then I guess he comes over to Hollywood and is mainly playing Germans.
Nazis, most likely.
Yeah, probably. I'm not familiar with his roles in all of these films. He does something in Gilda, so yes, I'm assuming he's a Nazi in Gilda. But he also played the father of Al Jolson in the biopics, so that's interesting.
In the Jolson story?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I have seen those, but a very long time ago.
Thinking about all of these actors and what became of their careers when they were forced to emigrate to Hollywood, their prospects were very much shrunken, as were the directors who are working here at Universal.
Like Siodmak, director of Son of Dracula.
And Joe Mai. Underlines the strangeness of this time period as reflected in this weird little film. The strange fates of all of these people, that they were working, educated and working in these major cultural centers like Vienna and Berlin, on the stage and in film, and then they come to Hollywood and they're making weird B-movies at Universal.
A lot of these actors I've seen before. Ludwig Stossel is one of the great genial European character actors that you see throughout the 40s. He's in Casablanca, you know, What Watch, Such Much. Here he's a real bootlicking creep, right? He's the one that reports our hero for making fun of the Führer.
So he wasn't only playing Nazis then?
No, he usually played nice guys, nice old guys who might be a refugee from Europe somewhere, right?
But he was born in Lockenhaus, now Austria, then Hungary, and he was another Jewish actor who fled the Nazis. Back to Ludwig Donau.
Yeah.
It is a very affecting performance in a weird role where the acting feat is that he has to make you feel his humanity despite the fact that he's wearing the face of Hitler.
Affects his wife. She goes to kill him in the streets and she can't do it because she sees something in his eyes.
And it really is these eyes, these sad eyes staring out of Hitler's face.
But he also played Hitler in the movie, right? And when he plays Hitler, he looks like a maniac.
But Hitler doesn't talk. I thought that was interesting.
No, that's true. Yeah, he's able to make his eyes look nice or not nice. I'm not sure if I could do that.
You think you can only make your eyes look nice?
I don't know. An actor presumably can alter those windows to the soul in different ways. Pretty impressive.
Did you know that Gail Sondergaard's husband was one of the Hollywood 10, Dave?
No, I don't think I did know that. Who was she married to?
Herbert Biberman.
Okay. Well, she's a very interesting actor. She's probably most famous these days for being the original choice to play the Wicked Witch of the West, except that she was too beautiful, so they got rid of her.
You brought that up. There are many different versions of this story. One that I read while researching for this episode is that they were going to put her in the ugly makeup, but she thought that would be bad for her career, so she refused it.
Play many different things, and here she is very affecting as the wife and mother whose home is disintegrating, both because her husband has been taken away by the Nazis and her children are being taken away from her in a different, more insidious way by their schoolmasters and their scoutmasters.
So while I was reading online all of these summaries of this film, all the plot summaries were radically different from each other. It was making me start to doubt what I'd seen. So these members of the Gestapo who are surrounding Franz Huber, who have enlisted him to do this double job, they're not planning to kill Hitler and replace him, are they? Because that's one plot summary I saw.
No,
they just want him as a body double.
Yeah, it's the generals who are a different group, right? I mean, they're another group of cackling German men, so maybe there's confusion there. The movie doesn't take great pains to individualize these people. That group is kind of hoping that Hitler will die or go away somehow.
But they're not plotting it.
No. They're okay. Just expressing a great wish, and they're so happy when they hear that someone has walked up to Hitler and shot him in Vienna. And of course, they go too far and start making Schickelgruber jokes while Hitler walks in and rips their epaulets off and condemns them to death.
It might have been a good plot twist if they had decided that they wanted to get rid of him, but that doesn't actually happen.
No, no.
So the basic science fiction alternate universe premise in the movie has to do with this retreat that the generals want to do. They think Hitler is being irrational in not ordering the retreat. Do you have any input on that, Dave, as to who's right here, Hitler or the generals?
I think at the time, certainly, everyone was big on drawing parallels to Napoleon went too far,
right.
Hitler went too far trying to invade the Soviet Union. Hubris was going to doom the Nazis, and the German high command in this movie is presented as slightly more rational, but also megalomaniacal and bent on conquering the world one way or the other, but they think that what they've been doing in the Soviet Union has not been productive. In hindsight, now I'm no scholar of the battle details and grand strategy of World War II, but I have some understanding of the drift of the historiography, and my sense is that I don't think these discussions really would have happened. I think everyone knew that they had to invade the Soviet Union and had to win, or else they were going to be defeated anyway, because they needed the oil fields in the Soviet Union. If they didn't get those, they would not have been able to continue the war against the Americans who were now in the war, etc. So it's all about resources, and whether Hitler was insane and was invading Russia because he had some kind of sense of grand destiny about it, or whether there were actually engineers in his camp telling him, we need to go to the Soviet Union and get those Baku oil fields and secure them, comes to the same thing ultimately. They had to do it. Same way that the Japanese had to do what they did. They needed resources. They could not have avoided attacking the United States. They had to go into U.S. possessions if they wanted to keep their war machine going. The only thing they could have done is decided to, oh yeah, we'll stop being an evil empire and just make peace with everybody. But obviously, that was not in the cards. So if they wanted to keep fighting, they had to do this. They couldn't be halfway rational the way these generals are talking about being.
The movie's premise is if you get rid of the evil leader, that's not going to solve anything because there's an evil administration behind him.
There's the deep state.
Right.
Which, that is certainly true. You know, in the case of the Nazis, getting rid of Hitler would have done nothing.
I'm going to go too deep if I go down this road. I was going to say it's arguable that they would have had to have employed their power in a different way with the citizens if they didn't have this charismatic leader.
I'm not sure it mattered by 1943. I think everyone in Germany...
Everyone was with the program by then?
Yeah, or dead in concentration camps, or in the army fighting for their lives, whether they agreed with the cause or not. If Hitler had been killed in 1934, yes, that would have made a huge difference. Although, again, maybe someone else would have just stepped in with the same ideas, but maybe less crazy.
Right.
I mean, one thing that I think we can say for sure is that if Hitler had been killed sometime in the 30s, the Nazi revolution might have continued. There might have still been World War II. They probably would not have engineered the Holocaust. So that's a huge thing. But by 1943, that's already well underway. For that, it would certainly be worth it. Except I'm not sure, because I don't know who would have stepped in. There might have been someone else as insanely anti-Semitic as Hitler. So in that sense, maybe Fritz Kortner is wrong, and killing Hitler would have been a good idea, even in 1943. There were a lot of people killed between 1943 and 1945 in death camps. Horrible situation. Very grim turn of events here in our podcast talking about this, but it's worth discussing. You know, is Fritz Kortner right when he looks at the camera
but
and
this
says...
This is the point of the movie. But also, the further point that he makes at the end seems to be, well, first of all, that we have to keep fighting. It's not enough to just kill the big bad Nazi. Lots of people are a Nazi. Everybody's got a potential to be a Nazi. We've got to choose to be something that's not a Nazi, and then fight the Nazis, and then fight them all till they're all gone.
Yeah.
That's what he says. Making the singular choice of being a singular hero who kills a singular villain isn't going to work. You have to band together with us to fight them.
Yeah, it's like Fritz Kortner is talking to all of the people writing time travel stories about going back in time and killing Hitler and saying, it's not going to do it. You're going to have to do more. You're going to just have to fight World War II anyway. It's certainly an interesting point of view put across forcefully.
He is trying to exhort people to join or support the resistance.
Yeah, absolutely.
The idea that you have to band together as a group, as a community.
Yeah, and I think he's right about all of that. Some of the statements that we get from the movie about Stalingrad being just a folly of Hitler's and the generals would know better and that kind of thing, I'm not sure if that stands up, but the general idea that you have to oppose the entire Nazi party and the ideology of fascism rather than just one guy who happened to become the head of it.
Well, the historical accuracy isn't as important as the idea that you could, because already all these stories are going around about linking the Nazis to occultism and irrationalism. There seems to be some truth to that, but I have not investigated exactly how much truth to it.
They make jokes about Hitler's astrologer.
Yeah, but the historical accuracy isn't as important as the idea that you could have a leader, a charismatic leader, who is completely irrational, a complete fool, fool, right? And therefore, if you get rid of him, you've just strengthened the cause of that side.
Sort of like the arguments people would make about how, well, if the Republican Party has to be in charge of the United States, it's probably better that it's Donald Trump because he's incompetent and can't really put through all of their agenda.
Yeah, that's not bad. It's not a bad analogy.
Sure, Hitler, Trump.
I don't know. I don't mean Trump is like Hitler.
He isn't so far off. You know, someone with the same platform, but less distracted by the little things he was getting himself distracted by, could have probably done even more damage. So that's the idea. That's one side of what the movie is giving us. The general's perspective on it is that they could work better unhampered by Hitler.
Yeah, but also people were predicting dire things to happen because of Trump's incompetence when he came into office, as if the president does anything.
Oh, he does do things.
Some things, but there's also an entire administration. Well, of course, Trump's administration was incompetent because he was understaffing it or something initially.
They got some bad things done. Let's not underestimate how evil they were. But they weren't as effective at destroying American infrastructure as Reagan's government was, for instance.
Right, and I guess that was a trickle-down effect of his bad leadership.
So it would seem.
I don't know, I'm just trying to think of all the different ways you can make the movie these arguments work, all the different analogies you could find for what they're saying. It's just not dependent on Donald Trump and Hitler being similar in any way.
No, that's the macro level. And the micro level, I find more heart-wrenching. This family just crumbling. You get a little bit of a callback to The Mortal Storm with kids becoming Nazis.
Any kind of portrayal of a totalitarian society, you're going to get this idea of family turning against family and neighbor turning against neighbor and friend against friend in the name of ideological purity or just saving your own skin. But these children, yes, are being brainwashed. That's one of the most blatant aspects of the film, the way in which the children are being literally brainwashed to believe that Hitler is greater than God.
Yeah, and their mother is evil for trying to arrange for them to escape to Switzerland.
And notably, the little blonde boy is much more happily embracing this ideology than his dark-haired little brother.
That's true. The friend of the family is a pretty interesting character.
So maybe this is supposed to be part of the film's exploitation aspect, this storyline of the Austrian women being threatened by the Nazi soldiers being stationed with them.
Yeah, billeted. So they're at the Russian front for months on end, and then they're sent back into the capitals of Europe to
rape
and pillage, and it's only their right.
Do you think this would be accurate at all, or is this just sheer lurid propaganda?
Honestly, I don't know. I mean, we know that soldiers do this kind of stuff fairly often.
Yeah, but in this particular kind of way, where you're stationed in a middle-class woman's home?
Yeah, and would the military tribunal just say, sorry, lady, you're supposed to accept their advances?
Like, this seems part of what you were saying, where this is being portrayed as an occupying force to maybe a greater degree than was actually the case.
Of course they do, to the extent that she claims to be engaged to be married. Then they're like, oh, well, that's different. But you better go do it right now or else I won't believe you. In this movie, they have some sentimentality about the German home and the German housewife if she's married, but if she's a widow or unmarried, I guess she's fair game, according to the judges that we meet in this movie, or the court martial.
I guess this is Trudy Berliner portraying Frau Reitler.
Yeah, she kills herself rather than be returned to these evil soldiers who are hounding her across the city.
She is yet another Jewish performer who fled the Nazis. She was from Berlin, and she was a famous cabaret performer, and also appeared in films.
It's a small role, but makes a real impression, that's for sure.
It's hard to describe the tone of this movie.
I mean, it starts out in a lighthearted manner, right? The jokes about Hitler doing his imitations and these bureaucrats who don't really believe in the Nazi ideology, but are just trying to get by without being noticed too much by the high command.
Well, other than this friend who is not really a friend and who is more ambitious than he's letting on.
We don't know that at first, although you can kind of get a sense he's being disingenuous when he congratulates Huber for getting the promotion instead of him.
It was just, to me, it was just completely surreal to see these, well, not actual Nazi officials, but part of the Nazi administration, sharing jokes about that silly Hitler.
And then he comes home and greets his family and the beloved family friend, and he's telling people confidentially, I think we're gonna lose. It has this really jovial beginning, and then of course everything goes to hell very soon after that when the Gestapo break in and drag him off. But it's all the more effective for that, because it did take me off guard. I thought we were going to get a little bit more of a caricature of the situation.
And well, that's what I mean by the tonal oddness of the movie.
Any thought that we're going to have a domestic haven in this movie is trampled when they barge through the door and they drag him off to Berlin. And I guess you get a little bit of a recurrence of the comedy when everyone's asking him to do his imitations and they're all looking very stern and serious, but they can't help laughing at the different imitations he does, and especially the one of Hitler.
Yeah, they're laughing at each other. Well, I guess the surreality of the opening scenes is that I'm sure other movies like this exist, but I'm not used to seeing Nazi collaborators portrayed as just ordinary middle-class people who are trying to get by.
An ingenious aspect of the film, because it's saying the temptation for anyone under any kind of a government that they disagree with is to try to get by.
And I guess this and their decision to take individual heroic action, I guess those are the things that create their tragic downfall.
Whereas Fritz Kortner will fight on and eventually triumph, and a new Europe will be born thanks to teamwork.
It still seems unbelievably cruel, their fate, because we really do get to like these people. We don't really recall that they were originally Nazi collaborators, and that's how they got into this situation. But that's exactly it. It drives home the movie's point that the choices are stark here. If you don't want to be a collaborator, you're going to have to join the resistance. You're going to have to make a complete commitment.
Yeah, it's a very disturbing ending. It doesn't feel trite at all when she shoots her own husband, even though you know that's kind of where it's heading.
It's so horrifying. And
then they just gun her down.
And this whole performance of this man trapped inside Hitler's body, because literally the Nazis do an experiment and plastic surgery him into Hitler.
Yeah, grim stuff.
It's a very bad nightmare. You wake up and you're not a giant insect, you're Hitler. And when he sees himself in the mirror,
pure Twilight Zone.
One other scene we should talk about, or one other aspect, is when Gail Sondergaard is plotting how she's going to kill Hitler.
She goes to the rally?
Yeah, it's through this petition, and she starts talking to that old lady. Again, I don't know what the accuracy of this is, but the idea is that the Nazis are trying to make it look like Hitler's a good guy and his administrators are the bad guys, so that citizens will stay sympathetic to Hitler, despite all the stories about how he's a bad guy. So with these petitions, you can petition him to have your family freed from a concentration camp. It must be Bauer, Fritz Kortner, who says that these are all staged.
Yeah.
But this woman has been completely suckered into it. So this is another example of a good Austrian citizen who absolutely loves Hitler.
Yeah, well,
because of the propaganda. But that sounds very QAnon, doesn't it? Like, secretly, Hitler is fighting the good fight.
No, that's not it. It's just that if you happen to appeal to him or gain his favor in some way, he'll do you a solid. And
No. Specifically, the way Fritz Kortner paints it is that the idea is to make it look like Hitler is just being thwarted by his evil administrators and is really a good guy. Yeah, that's what he says.
If they could just get his ear, he's a good guy, you know, he'll fix everything for us.
That's just exactly what I was saying.
Yeah, but it's not that Hitler doesn't believe in Nazi ideology. Hitler will be your friend and help with your problems, but he's not at cross purposes with the Nazi bureaucracy. It's just that if you happen to run afoul of them, he'll help you out because he's your personal savior. I mean, that's how it comes across in the movie,
I guess.
But that woman was a Nazi, no doubt.
His administrators were hardened.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, she's a Nazi, but also the whole idea of petitioning him is to, as I said, have your family freed from a concentration camp. So can you be a Nazi and also want your family to get out of the concentration camp?
Yeah, if you believe they were unjustly accused, right? Concentration camps were for anyone that caused any problems. And of course, a lot of it was ethnically determined, but not all of it. So if you happen to speak out of turn, you could be sent to a concentration camp. And the idea of the petition is that you could convince Hitler that, no, this person that I care about is not really an enemy of the state and should be freed. And that's kind of what we're told in that scene. Yeah, Hitler's flexible. If you can get his ear, he'll do something and speak up on your behalf because you can't do it alone. But that woman immediately starts trying to get them to arrest Fritz Kortner. She is a rabid Nazi.
I know, I'm just trying to think. Bauer is correct in his assessment. What is the wider point of portraying Hitler this way?
Because, like I was saying, he's supposed to be everyone's personal savior. He's supposed to be someone that you believe cares about you and your problems. Yes, he's hard on everyone else, but not on me, because he knows me and cares about me.
So it's not trying to soften his image. It's not trying to work against a perception that Hitler is bad. It's just supposed to enhance his personal charisma even more.
Yeah, exactly. Just because he happens to like you, the laws don't apply to you.
But it's supposed to be staged, just like a faith healing.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I guess it has the logic of the faith healing as well.
It does indeed. Yeah, the law has been suspended in your case only because of your special relationship with this being that's in contact with superior forces. Back to the universal story, director Robert Siodmak brought immense flair to Son of Dracula, turning Eric Taylor's otherwise trite screenplay, wherein Lon Chaney Jr., as Dracula Fiss, marries Louise Albritton, an occult worshipper who believes him to be a Hungarian count, into a more than passable example of the horror genre. The usual isolated mansion in surrounding woodland countryside, complete with nocturnal killings, vampire style, lent atmosphere to the tale, with second-billed Robert Page, as Miss Albritton's erstwhile fiancé, spoking the wheel of the couple's antisocial behavior by killing them. Frank Craven played a small-town doctor, and J. Edward Bromberg, a psychologist, both of whom Page consults before killing the bloodthirsty couple, with other roles going to Evelyn Ankers, Samuel S. Hines, Adeline DeWalt Reynolds, and Patrick Moriarty. The producer was Ford Beebe.
So Siodmak, as of the following year, is going to become something of a noir auteur, right?
Yeah, and I think that's our lens here, right? This is the horror genre tipping into film noir.
Not sure I would say that the screenplay was trite. The movie had an interesting tone, and that it felt very much... all of the scenes where the good guys are trying to figure out the plot, figure out what's going on, and there's a lot of talk what to do about it, right? All of those scenes are very, very B-movie, and they're shot in a very, very basic way, and they're really silly. You wish they were a little crazier, like, it could go into Ed Wood territory if they were a little crazier, but they're not. They're just
Frank Craven turning over that suitcase and going, D-R-A?
Okay.
That is so wonderful. I love it. Frank Craven's a great actor. I mean, he was the stage director in Our Town, you know? Like, yeah. The character.
Yeah. Well, when we talked about Todd Browning's Dracula, I was saying it seems absurd in this stage play that the movie was based on that Dracula is this great immortal devil, and yet he comes to London and he's immediately discovered. His sleeping place is immediately discovered and he's immediately destroyed. Like a snap of your fingers, like nothing is easier. Like how is this possible that Dracula is so easily defeated? Well, in this movie, because he just fucking doesn't disguise his name well enough.
Alucard.
If he had just taken a different name, no one would ever have known and they would have been fine.
And he's not the son of Dracula. I mean, that's the name of the movie, but he's just Dracula. What I love about this movie is that the casting of Lon Chaney Jr. is inspired because he is a terrible actor. He is a schlub.
He's actually really good in this, though. I don't know him from other movies, but he's actually a really effective presence in this.
Well, I disagree, but the thing for me that makes it great is that that throws into relief what this really is, which is a story about the far greater villainy of Louise Albritton, who's a femme fatale who has lured Dracula to America so that she can become immortal, and then she's gonna double-cross him and kill him.
I know.
It's amazing. That's the film noir aspect of it.
You're right.
She's not being misled by Dracula. She's in charge.
You're right that Dracula, or Son of Dracula, or Alucard, he does just completely fall by the wayside. And she is the real villain of the piece. I just thought he was filmed very effectively.
Oh, he was. Yeah, Siodmak does a great job of filming him, but that's different from saying that Lon Chaney Jr. is a good actor, because he's really not.
No, he's just standing there being filmed in interesting ways.
Yeah, the mustache helps a little.
And the big sad sack face, it's effective. I'm not familiar with his other performances.
Now, the film credits him just as Lon Chaney, and I guess he is the only living Lon Chaney in 1943, so that's fair, but this is not the great Lon Chaney of 1920s universal fame.
So yes, so the story is very original, and I don't know if that should be credited to Kurt Siodmak, Robert's brother, who wrote the story on which the screenplay was based. So I definitely wouldn't call it trite. It does seem to look forward to experiments like Francis Ford Coppola's Dracula, right? His weird feminist Dracula?
Yeah.
With the same sort of idea, but even more so, because, as you said, it's not a matter of Dracula trying to seduce this woman into immortal life. She already has the idea from her occult pursuits.
It's like she went looking for him. She turned up Dracula and then says, hey, come to get some new blood over in America. It's all a trap.
Yeah, and her whole idea was that she's going to turn her childhood sweetheart.
Yeah, she actually loves him and wants to live forever with him.
So she's actually more like Gary Oldman's character in the Francis Ford Coppola Dracula.
Yeah, to some extent. I think Louise Albrighton is really effective in this movie. She's really scary.
Yeah, she is. Once she gets turned, yeah. So this is like the movie's slow revelation.
Yeah, because you think, okay, this poor deluded girl, she's been mesmerized by this evil Eastern European. It's not her fault.
Well, yeah, I mean, the other interest of it is to read it intertextually with the Todd Browning Dracula and compare this couple to the couple of Helen Chandler and David Manners in that movie, right? And I mean, she is turned evil and she does try to seduce David Manners, but he is unseducible.
And she pulls back.
Yeah, right.
She wasn't a willing participant. She was pulled into this by Bela Lugosi. And that's certainly not what's going on here. This Dracula is a tool in someone else's scheme.
So having established that, when we ultimately get to that point, and how are these, like, why is Frank Craven even in this movie? Like, what is happening with people's careers at this point?
I think he just decided it would be fun to do. I mean, you see Frank Craven turn up in all kinds of odd places, but I always enjoy him, and he's having a ball with his character.
This is getting toward the end of his film career.
Yeah.
Well, he died in 1945.
Yeah, I mean, he's old.
Oh, he was also in State Fair?
Yeah.
Yeah, he doesn't seem like he has a contract with Universal or anything.
No, I think he was a freelancer at this point, just turning up wherever they needed a Frank Craven type.
Is that what this role called for?
He's not exactly analogous to Van Helsing, because that's more the Bromberg character.
Mm-hmm.
But he's the one that makes it possible for a Van Helsing to be called upon. He's a little suspicious from the beginning of everything that's going on. You know, from the moment that he sees Alucard backwards seems to be Dracula, he's got an inkling that there's a problem here. But he is taking some chances at first, and he's a skeptic, but, you know, not a skeptic to the same extent that the sheriff is, who just won't believe even after people start getting their blood sucked out of their throats and there's no mystery about that and people are turning up in mists.
Well, I love the fact that every time Bromberg tells him something, he's like, that can't be, that's incredible, that's impossible, and then like 5 minutes later he's totally accepted it and he's on to the next revelation.
Yeah, and again, Frank Craven plays that beautifully so that the comedy value comes across with maximum impact. I mean, he knows that this is silly and crazy and he's having a lot of fun with it.
Joseph Bromberg, yet another Jew from Austria-Hungary.
I know him best from Strange Cargo.
And a communist, by the way.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Apparently he had a defiant appearance before the House Un-American Activities Committee shortly before his death.
Oh, man. Well, he was really good. My friend, I'm something of an expert on Dracula and vampires. You came to the right person.
And how calmly, I love the best comedy between these two, is how calmly, it is almost getting to Anthony Hopkins' Van Helsing in the Coppola Dracula, how calmly the two of them decide, oh, I guess we're going to have to destroy him. Oh, I guess we're going to have to destroy her too. Drat! Oh well, we're going to have to do it. Let's cremate her. Get her sister involved. Cremate her. And then she, conversely, is having this conversation in the cell with her increasingly deranged boyfriend. Oh, and he goes so crazy.
Yeah.
He has a complete breakdown. It's awesome.
Yeah, I think Robert Page is pretty good in this movie. He gets put through the ringer and he allows himself to become very disheveled, not at all leading man looking at certain points.
And she likewise is just like, oh, my sister's going to cremate me, well, I'm gonna have to destroy her. She's gonna stand against me, she's my enemy now.
Yep.
Everyone is just very swiftly picking sides and going to have to kill everybody else.
But the thing is, she does play fair from the beginning, right? Because she tells her fiancé, just trust me, I do love you, and I do want to marry you and be with you always. And of course you're thinking, no, why is she lying? Why does she keep lying? She's even telling him this after she's gotten married to Dracula. But she's not lying. She's telling the truth. She has loved this guy since they were kids, and she just wants it to go on for much longer than the usual human lifespan.
So of course you always reach the point in these movies where, the Dracula movies, where the good guys are bearing down on the evil vampires, and you desperately want the vampires to escape. All they want is to be immortal.
And to drain people's blood and kill them.
Yeah, but nobody's ever really very concerned about that. They're concerned about the fact that the vampires are evil. It is a fact that they are evil, and they therefore have to be destroyed, right? It's not really a consequentialist ethics, it's a essentialist ethics.
Well, that's an interesting point of view. I mean, I think there is a utilitarian value to getting rid of vampires. Maybe that's not emphasized by the film.
Don't you want her to get away with it? And don't you want her to turn this guy? Don't you want her to get her wish? Wouldn't you like to live forever with your childhood sweetheart? It's like Kathy and Heathcliff.
No, because they have to be evil to do it. It's not... I don't find that seductive.
How are they more evil than anybody eating anything?
Well, they're going around sucking little kids' blood.
So you think that's the line? If they were sucking adult blood, that would be okay.
No, but I'm saying the movie definitely makes a point of showing that they're preying upon little children,
well,
too.
That's what I'm saying. The movie is emphasizing that they're evil and not just that they need to eat, basically.
Right. Well, sure. I think there's room for both interpretations there, or both at the same time. There is an element of envy there. Why do they get to live forever? Gotta go kill them. The movie leaves you in doubt as to whether Frank is going to cast his lot with the vampires or go on a rampage killing them. Is he actually going to do what his fiance wants him to do, which is go kill Dracula so that they can be together?
Well, he does do that.
It's true.
The movie gets pretty fucking crazy at that point.
It does.
Dracula throws him into the flames at one point.
Yeah, well, he tries to douse the flames with Frank's body. But that doesn't work, and Dracula can't put it out himself. It's a sad end for a great villain.
Yeah, but it's better to have him defeated by this Machiavellian woman than for the doctor and the Van Helsing light to get him.
No, I agree. It's Dracula shoehorned into The Postman Always Rings Twice or Double Indemnity.
Yeah, they just want him for his money. Or in other words,
his cash value.
His gift of immortality.
It's pretty incredible when you think of it that way. I guess that is the genius of the Siodmak brothers to usher the universal horror film into the mid-40s noir.
Phantom Lady is very insane.
A lot of these Siodmak movies are, and Universal is a major player in the noir revolution that's coming.
But it's also interesting that we never see the part where she manages to seduce Dracula.
No, because that would screw everything up, because you're supposed to be thinking that it happened the expected way. Young girl on a holiday in Eastern Europe, and she gets led astray by the mesmeric powers of the vampire.
But we do see them turn up in the middle of the night to get married by a justice of the peace.
Yeah, that was amazing. Dracula and I want to get married. Is that okay?
Do you think they needed to take a blood test? So this movie, spoilers, also ends with someone having to kill the person that they love.
Yeah, he sets his beloved fiance on fire.
That's a pretty crazy expression on Robert Page's face when that's happening.
I mean, he's really driven to the edge of madness and possibly beyond.
How did this guy ever get together with this woman? Like, she's really gone off the rails.
Well, they were childhood sweethearts.
Yeah, but they really philosophically departed.
That can happen, you know, and those childhood attachments linger on. Forgot what you ever had in common.
All you had in common was childhood.
One thing that I always forget is that they don't do anything with him and Evelyn Anchors, the good sister.
No.
You know, she seems to like him. She's very interested in what's going on with him. And she's very worried about the drift of her sister's mind. But he doesn't wind up in a clinch with Evelyn Anchors. There's no sense that they're going to console each other.
No, he winds up staring with an appalled expression on his face as his beloved burns.
It's a much better choice. We've certainly seen plenty of movies where there's a convenient good girl available to step into the place of the woman who's gone mental and consorted with demons.
You would have thought that that would happen after the flame scene.
Doesn't.
That's a touch of Universal, isn't it? Very uncompromising ending of Bride of Frankenstein, for example.
Well, this is a different Universal by the 40s.
Even the Black Cat gets a happy ending. Technically, so does the Bride of Frankenstein, because always there are two good lovers who escape, but not here.
No, here, I guess Frank Craven and Bromberg have had a great old time, and they never are seriously in danger in this movie.
They never accomplish anything but exposition.
Just all the stuff with Craven rearranging the letters never fails to delight me when I see this movie. It is very different from all the other horror movies that Universal was making in the 40s, too, because so many of them are just slugfests between different monsters. I don't like those very much at all. Eventually, we'll see some. They have their following. This does have a lot more atmosphere and a lot less monster mash attitude about it.
The interest of this movie is the fact that the atmosphere does not permeate it.
Only in certain moments of misty evil.
The sort of procedural exposition scenes are allowed to just be completely banal.
I'm not sure I agree with you. They're goofy enough that I find them extremely fun to watch because they're...
Yeah, but I mean, they're banal in the way they're written and shot.
Oh, certainly. They're just relying on prose to deliver the dialogue in a way that makes the comedy plain.
Even Todd Browning's Dracula has the moment between the servants for a comedy.
Oh, sure. Me old fly eater. Who wrote the screenplay?
Eric Taylor, B-movie mystery writer. He was one of the screenwriters on The Black Cat, but other than that, it's a whole lot of Ellery Queens, and there's a Dick Tracy in there. So serials, B-serials.
So this was his one big moment to step even a little bit out of that mode, because this was a big hit, right?
It was a hit, yes. It was a hit for Universal.
Well, bravo, Universal. You bring 1943 to a close with two very weird films, as we would expect from you.
Very weird and very despairing.
Next week on the podcast, it's the return of Dorothy McGuire. We're at part 11. Not too many Dorothy McGuire episodes left. We're going to be talking about Dark at the Top of the Stairs, which I've never seen, and Swiss Family Robinson. So a return to the Disneyverse.
Yeah, have not seen that since I was a child.
No, me neither. See you then.